you sort of lift yourself up and you start to feel the balance of the machine. Your arms control the outside legs, your legs control the inside legs, but really you pilot it with your gut. All of a sudden sort of you realize that if you so much as twitch your arm, the whole 9,000 pound machine will move on you, and then you kind of realize what you're in for. And that's when it gets exciting.
We're taking you inside a real-life human-driven mech suit that blurs the lines between science fiction and reality. This mechanical behemoth can lift a car, climb over boulders, and move over all kinds of terrain. It's called Prosthesis. Standing 4 meters tall and 5 meters wide, the machine towers over you, and it weighs more than twice your average car. Now, you may think this technology was clearly built to explore Mars or to be used by the military, but its inventor had other ideas.
The thing was built to race. It was built to rip around the countryside.
Mech suits are powered exoskeletons and are typically something you'd see in science fiction. But mechanical engineer Jonathan Tippett is hoping to change your mind.
Mech suits in sci-fi have all had a very specific purpose, and it's essentially for combat, which has not been an inspiration for me. This has always been about the human experience. When I started to try and articulate why it was so important to me to build this machine that was human controlled and that required skill and sort of celebrated the pilot inside, it became apparent that what I was creating was a sports machine.
That's right. Jonathan wants to race his mechs, but we'll come back to that later. First, let's dig into the origins of Prosthesis.
The machine itself started as an art project for Burning Man. I wanted to build a machine that celebrated human skill and augmented it using technology, but still kept the human at the heart. 2006 was the first sketch I did of the machine, and back then it was very gorilla shaped. And for about 5 or 6 years, I just did sketches and CAD and engineering, just trying to figure out the mechanics of how to make a machine of that scale.
Then around 2010, Jonathan and a team of engineers started building the predecessor to Prosthesis. They called the machine the Alpha Leg.
First full system functional test.
The Alpha Leg was a wild sort of bucking bronco of a machine, and it proved the basic concept that you could control an exoskeletal mech suit from inside while you were being hurled around by it. You wouldn't lose control of the things.
Using Alpha Leg as a jumping off point, Prosthesis was then built over the course of a year. By 2017, it was ready for its worldwide debut at CES.
At that point, the thing barely worked. And, you know, we had a hard time convincing the world that this was going to lead to a racing league. The vision we have for mech racing is like a giant, complex technical obstacle course. And you've got pro-level athletes strapped into these super powerful, agile mech suits, navigating these obstacles.
However, the technology was still a long way from Jonathan's vision.
So then we kind of went underground, and between 2017 and 2019, we iterated the control system 2 or 3 times, made the interface more ergonomic, more comfortable.
The result was a 4,000 kilogram, 200 horsepower, all-electric, human-controlled mech suit built for competitive sport.
Its full name is Prosthesis the Anti-Robot. We specifically called it that because it's not a robot. A robot, by definition, has some level of autonomy. The goal of this machine is to not automate. This is a mech suit. It's a exoskeleton.
Prosthesis is engineered to work like the giant robots and mech suits you might see in the movies like Pacific Rim and Avatar. The mech is controlled by a person. Without a human, it can't go anywhere or really do anything.
You have to climb onto the top of the machine. There's a small opening in the roof, and you kind of snake your way through the exoskeletal interface opening. And once you kind of squeeze your way into the cockpit, all of a sudden you kind of expand out into this body-shaped control interface, and it suddenly becomes comfortable. The control system picks up the pilot's inputs and amplifies them by about 50 times.
You heard that right. According to Jonathan, the operator's strength is boosted by 50.
There's a dashboard in front of the pilot, and you power up the pumps. The hydraulic pumps give power to the hydraulic cylinders, which make the machine move. The machine comes online, and you grip the hand grip, and it activates the controls, and the machine sort of like jolts into life. Your arms control the outside legs, Your legs control the inside legs, but really you just feel it. You practice enough and it just becomes part of you. From there on, it's all up to pilot skill to balance the machine. And that's kind of where the fun starts.
And by fun, he means taking it out to the Mojave Desert or the forests of British Columbia. But that's far from the end goal. Jonathan wants a full-on racing league with trained pilots controlling these massive mech suits. So to realize this dream, he started to recruit pilots.
And one of the goals of the Alpha Mech Pilot Program is to start bringing different kinds of people into the sport and putting them in the machine and learning what kind of skills make a good mech pilot. Generally, like good body awareness, people who do gymnastics and snowboarding. And what we're finding is that it's skill-based. It's not strength-based, even though it's this huge thing.
In addition to new recruits, Jonathan and his team of engineers are already looking ahead to the next phase of development.
Now that we're starting to reach the limits of this machine's potential, the timeline to build the next generation of mech is a lot shorter than 14 years. We'd like to see the next generation of mech come out in the next 12 to 18 months, and we'll be probably two-thirds the size, half the weight, and twice the power. I think we could probably see that thing doing 15, 20 kilometers an hour. 5-10 years from now, we'll be doing 20, 30 kilometers an hour.
While new suits and professional pilots would bring mech racing one step closer to reality, there are some critics.
There's been no shortage of skeptics over the years, that's for sure. And usually when I get met with incredulity or skepticism, people ask me, why am I doing this? More often than not, it just spurs me to try harder, because if people just shied away from things that people thought were crazy, then there would be no innovation.
And it's this idea of pushing tech and human skill to its limits that could lead to exoskeletons developed for search and rescue missions here on Earth, or mechs engineered to explore Mars.
Obviously, the core purpose for this is sport, but the whole trajectory of building a racing league first gives us an opportunity to sort of incubate that technology in the heat of competition. The potential for this technology and this sport over the next 2 to 5 years is almost limitless.